Morning and welcome to worship at Beckwith Hills. We are so glad that you have joined us this morning in worship, whether you're worshiping with us live here in the worship center or if you are joining us on live streaming. We are glad that you are worshiping with us. It's our intention, it's our hope, it's our focus to lift the name of Jesus Christ in our worship. And that's what we want to do in heart, mind, and body. So we gather to worship. And for those of you who don't know me, if you're a guest with us or if you're returning from a summer of vacations or something and you're back, my name is Stan Stirring. And I'm serving as a transitional pastor here to lead us in God's path to our next step together as a congregation. So it's my privilege to be with you and worship with you as well. We do have connect cards that are available in the little holders on the back of the bench in front of you. You can fill that one of those out if you would like to connect with us in some way, and we can connect with you. There are also prayer cards. This is a praying church, and so if you have a prayer request or a need that we can, or even a thanks or a praise that we can pray with you or for you, you can fill those out, and either of these cards can be put in little boxes that are on the side walls in the back of the worship area, or you can drop them in the offering plate as the offering plate comes by, and we will get those to the right people so that we can be in contact with you or praying for you. As we gather to worship God this morning, my heart is a bit heavy because of what's going on in our world. War has broken out in Israel, and it's 50 years since the war of 1973, which was called the Yom Kippur War. Yom is the Hebrew word for day. Kippur is atonement. It was meant to be a day of atonement, and people have used it for violence and war and hatred and murder. People have been taken hostage. We know these things. We can find them out in the news. It's my intention just to pause as we come to the Lord of all creation to stop for a moment and recognize that our worship of God happens in a broken, violent world. And so I would just ask if you would pause with me and pray with me for just a moment. Father in heaven, we come before you. You are our creator and our redeemer. You are the Lord of life. You are the one who offers us in Jesus Christ that atonement, that at being one again with you and with each other. That through the death of Jesus Christ, we can reach out with the good news of reconciliation. And yet, Lord, our world is once again plunged into the horrors of war. Lord, it's hard for us to put those things together, how you are Lord over this world and our world is so broken. We plead with you, Lord Jesus Christ, Prince of Peace, be the Lord of Peace and quickly bring this conflict to an end, to a resolution, to a place where people can once again live and dwell in safety, where lives can be spared. And we know that, Lord, in the horrors of war, many lives will be taken yet. And so we plead with you to bring an end to it quickly. And then, Lord, lead us in our worship of you this morning, that you might be honored and glorified. In Jesus' name we ask this. Amen. So we do bring our worship to God this morning. And I would ask that if you are able, that you would stand with us to sing this next song as we bring our worship to God. Come, behold the wondrous mystery. Gathered to behold the wondrous mystery that our God of life died on a cross so that we might have forgiveness of sins. And he greets us as we've gathered to worship him with these words, "Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power and the presence of the wondrous mystery of the Holy Spirit living in and among you. Amen." And with that grace and peace that we receive from God, please let that spill out of you to one another. Greet and welcome one another with grace and peace this morning.
Please pray with me. Holy God, together as one people, we bow this day before you because you are our God and we are your people. In the morning when we rise from our beds and our eyes behold the wonder of the vibrant pastels with which your creative genius paints the eastern skies, we cannot help ourselves from being filled with joy to know that in the day that follows, we will be walking in the glory of your mercies, which are new every morning. And when at eventide we see the blazing glory of a fiery, glorious sunset, we can be reminded, God, that you have bathed the hours of the passing day with your goodness and your faithfulness. And we can take great comfort in knowing that throughout the hours of darkness to come, we can lay ourselves upon our beds and sleep in restful peace. Because in the morning, when we awaken, we are still with you. And then in praise and worship we sing, Lord, our Lord in all the earth, how great is your name. Yours the name of matchless worth, excellent in all the earth. How great is your name. So, dear God, we bow in humility before you, understanding that we are your children, not because of who we are, but because of who you are. And this, too, leads us to another realm of wonder, because you are mysterious in Trinity, one God, three persons, very God of very God. And our minds cannot grasp this wonder, but our lack of understanding does not change you. It changes us. Oh God, we read in the Psalms that the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. That a broken spirit, O God, you will not despise. There are strong words for us today because we live in a world of unbridled pomposity. Our modern day culture is one pride party after another, and the lowly and the disenfranchised are increasingly cast aside. Even in our circles of faith, we hear of prideful piousity that divides the greater body of Christianity, that divides denominations of individual churches and even families. We even dare to look down our noses at those who think differently than we do about the smallest points of doctrine and practice. Lord God, Holy Father, forgive us. And help us to have a broken and contrite heart. In your grace, we ask it. And in humility now we pray, Holy Spirit, perfect our prayers as we pray for our world, a world torn apart by the ragings of war, as mentioned previously this morning, but also being torn apart by oppression and persecution, and the pride of human perversion. We pray for the conflict between Russia and Ukraine, along with that of Israel and its neighbors. God of peace, we hear of reports of further expansions of the aggression plans, and we hear rumblings of a former time when the earth was plunged into global conflict. We can only seek your power to bring salvation to the nations, God. We pray, Almighty Holy Father, that you will have mercy and change the hearts of aggressors, for only you can do that. We pray also for our nation, a nation that you have blessed with so much. For our nation, too, is sinking rapidly into a chaotic situation of political struggle that threatens peace and propriety. Struggles of power in the government structure, a structure of representation that is being stretched to the limits of fulfilling that very purpose. O God of glory, bring your presence and power to play upon our nation, that once again we can fulfill the motto, "In God we trust." And we also pray for our communities where we live and minister. We pray for justice and mercy to be present in the care of the poor and the needy, for those to whom Reverend Bob Arbogast ministers in Ionia Prison, for the courts to bring justice carefully and without bias. And we pray for the church where we worship. God, help us in this time of transition to discover and recommit to the way you would have us be a light in this great little neighborhood in which we live and minister. We're thankful to you that you are daily providing opportunity for us to share your love with our neighbors. And so we thank you, God, for Kayla and Tyler as they seek to minister in Christ, kids of Christ, the children of this Beckwith neighborhood. And we pray, God, that you would bring those children out, that they may know the love of Jesus. We thank you for the Patokas as they lead the Joy Club that ministers to just older youths. We thank you for the Dykemas, the Collins, and the Sycamas as they minister to the youth group. And we thank you for Kevin Sutsma and Pastor Stan Stirring as they serve you by leading us in worship and your word. Today, Heavenly Father, we pray your presence for the governing authority of our church, for the council as it meets this week. May they know your wisdom, and may they have the faith to continue to lead us. We thank you, God, that we can bring all these needs to you. And we pray that you would now bless those of our number who are struggling with health issues, with transition issues, with family struggles, with employment problems, are in the midst of spiritual skirmishes. Hold them and us in the powerful arms of Jesus so that we make it through and that we return praise and thanks to you. And we say again as we close our prayer today, Lord, our Lord, in all the earth, how great is your name. Yours the name of matchless worth, excellent in all the earth. How great is your name. In the name of Jesus, and we all say together, amen. Thank you.
we say together, we believe that Jesus Christ, according to his divine nature, is the only Son of God, eternally begotten, not made or created, for then he would be a creature. He is one in essence with the Father, co-eternal, the exact image of the person of the Father, and the reflection of God's glory, being like the Father in all things. Jesus Christ is the Son of God, not only from the time he assumed our nature, but from all eternity, as the following testimonies teach us when they are taken together.
Moses says that God created the world, and John says that all things were created through the Word, which he calls God. The apostle says that God created the world through the Son. He also says that God created all things through Jesus Christ.
And so it must follow that the one who is called God, the Word, the Son, and Jesus Christ already existed before creating all things.
Therefore, the prophet Micah says that Christ's origin is from ancient days, and the apostle says that the Son has neither beginning of days nor end of life.
So then, he is the true eternal God, the Almighty, whom we invoke, worship, and serve.
Our scripture this morning is from Colossians 1, 15 to 23. You can find that either on the screen in your own Bibles or in the Pew Bibles on page 1832. Before we read, please pray with me. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see you. We want to see you and believe in you as we read and hear your word. In the name of Jesus, amen. Colossians 1, 15 to 23. The superscription is the supremacy of Christ. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation if you continue in your faith, established and firm, not moved from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
What a Bible passage. 9 short verses, and yet so much contained in them. Just so you know, there is so much in this passage that this might be a 3 peppermint sermon. So you might want to be prepared for that. This past Tuesday, Melody and I, along with our son Chris, grabbed some food and sat out at Reed's Lake for supper. And on our walk back to the car, I asked if we should stop for ice cream because it was such a beautiful evening. My son said that he would prefer to get some ice cream from the grocery store and have it at home. He's a very private person. So I quickly ran into D&W and picked up some Hudsonville ice cream. And as I pulled it out of the freezer, I saw a young man holding a big bag or pack of bottled water on his shoulder as he pulled out a container of ice cream as well. And after being in separate lines at the checkout and paying for my ice cream, we happened to be walking out of the store at the same time, so I asked him what flavor of ice cream he picked out. And he said, Mackinac Island fudge. And then he asked me what I got, and I told him, triple peanut butter cup, deer tracks, and vanilla bean. He said, top of the line, top of the line. Novak Djokovic won the U.S. Open this year, and he has been ranked number one for a record total of 393 weeks in a record 12 different years, and finished as the year-end number one player a record 7 times. Djokovic has won an all-time record 24 Grand Slam men's singles titles, including a record 10 Australian Open titles. Overall, he has won 96 single titles, including a record 69 big titles, 24 majors, a record 39 masters, and a joint record 6 ATP finals. Djokovic is the only man in tennis history to be the reigning champion of all 4 majors at once across 3 different surfaces: grass, clay, and asphalt. In singles, he's the only man to achieve a triple career Grand Slam and the only player to complete a career Golden Masters, a feat which he achieved twice. A sports figure who is not only the best in their sport but has a longevity to their winning career is called a GOAT. What does that say? They're called a GOAT. What does that stand for? Greatest of all time. When we see something or when we experience something that is the best or even above and beyond the best, what language do we use to talk about it? Do we say this is outstanding? Or perhaps this is out of this world? Or do we use words like, hey, that's the top. That's top notch. That's over the top. Or would you say it's premium or primo? Or what's the word you use today? Bussin'? Do you use that word? Yeah? Kevin taught me that word, bussin'. It has the idea that it's just busting a move. It's the best. It's the greatest. It's bursting with flavor. The food is bussin'. It's just fantastic. Paul speaks of Jesus Christ in lofty language. There are words that he uses to lift up Christ, to set him apart from all others, and by distinguishing him in this way to draw our attention to who Jesus is and how we view him and how we live that out. We talk about this passage in Scripture in terms of, as Verla said, it's super titled, The Supremacy of Christ, where he stands supreme above all others. I wish they would have put in there that he was bussin'. Or we talk about his preeminence, his primacy. And the idea of being eminent is that of being famous or superior in terms of rank, position, character, or achievement. To be preeminent places one out even further. Of all the superior people, this one is the cream of the crop, the best of the best, truly the GOAT, the greatest of all time. Jesus is bussin'. Paul lists a number of ways that Jesus stands out. First, Christ is the very image or the best expression of who God is. Paul calls him the icon. And we get the word icon from it. But the word meant a mirror-like representation, an exact picture of God. If we want to know what God is like, we have to look no further than Jesus Christ. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. How can we see what is invisible to the human eye? God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. But how can we know what God is like? Jesus shows us. He's the very image, the best expression revealing who God is. Second, Paul says that Jesus is preeminent, prototokos, over all creation. Jesus has first place. And we hear in that Greek word prototokos, proto, like in a prototype. A prototype is an early sample, a model, or a release of a product built to test the ideas, the concepts, or the process. And future designs are based off that prototype then. While Jesus is the first, he is the proto, Paul says that he is the first brought forth over all creation. And this is Paul's way of saying that Jesus has the highest place over all creation. Paul is not saying that Jesus is part of the creation. Jesus is the unequaled ruler over all creation. It's almost as if the Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that God talked about creating and Jesus stepped forward and did it. In the Greek, it was the concept of the word logos, the word or the logic, the thought and the reason, the rationale behind it all that brought it about. So we read in the Bible, in the creation story, in Genesis, we hear, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and God said, let there be light. And there was light. He created it by his word. And in the Gospel of John, we learn that in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. And through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. John says that Jesus is the Logos, the word, the logic, the rational thought that brought it all about. He's that mind of God that is spoken in some mysterious, wonderful way at creation. He brought creation about. So Jesus is the firstborn over all creation, not in the sense of being created first, but in the ancient system of being the child who receives all the rights, privileges, power, and authority from the father. A Roman father could take a nephew, and Caesars have done this. They've taken a nephew, but a Roman father could take either a nephew or even a slave and invest them with adoption as their firstborn son to inherit everything in his household. And Jesus holds the place of the firstborn son over all creation. Thirdly, Paul goes on to say, Jesus has the place of preeminence over creation because he is the one through whom all things were created. We've already heard John say in his gospel, through him all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. Paul says that Jesus made all things in heaven and on earth, things we see and things that are unseen, things that are visible and things that are invisible. And then he then lists a number of the invisible things that Jesus is Lord over. Thrones, dominions, rulers, and authorities. A throne refers to one who holds dominion or exercises authority, and in the plural, thrones means of angels. Dominions, in which the word Lord is within it, kuriatetos, lordships, dominions point to angelic lordship, power, and dignity. And it's usually used in a suggestion of a hierarchy of spiritual beings. Rulers are the persons or things that begin something, or as the first person or thing in a series. The ruler then is the leader. So this term rulers is used by Paul to mean angels or demons holding dominions or domains entrusted to them in the order of things. And the authorities are the leading or more powerful among created beings, superior to people. In Psalm 8, David sang about God making and placing people in creation, and David said, "You have made them a little lower than the angels." So authorities are used then of a certain class of angels. And all four of these, Paul is talking about things that are invisible. Paul lists these angels or spiritual divisions or positions to say that Jesus is Lord over them. Jesus has created them all. They are part of the invisible, unseen creation that were made through Jesus. And Paul goes on to say, all creation, things seen and unseen, have been made for and to Jesus. Jesus is the one that all creation is heading toward or ending with. Jesus, in his own words, says that he is the Alpha and the Omega. We have it right here on the front of the pulpit. There is a torch, which can be understood either that Jesus is the light of the world or your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. But over that torch is an open Bible, and on that Bible are the Alpha and the Omega. Or you can see it in the window up here as well. The beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, are intertwined into each other. And Jesus is that. He is the beginning, and he is the one to whom all creation is meant for and is heading toward. He's the first and the last. He's our bookend, and he's got us surrounded. So fourthly, Paul says that Jesus was before all things, or prior to all created things. In the words of John, Jesus is the Word who was with God and is God. And Jesus astounded the people of his day with the claim that he made. When the Pharisees and the teachers of the law challenged the authority of Jesus, they were claiming Abraham as their father. And Jesus said, "Very truly, I tell you, before Abraham was born, I am." Pre-existent to Abraham and to creation. Next, Paul says Jesus is the one through whom all things hold together. Though we often speak and think of God's creative work of having been completed in the 6 days of creation, God has not left or abandoned his creative work. I still like to think that every new human being that is born, that is conceived and born, that every little bird that is born is still a creative act of God today. He's not done with creating his world. Every blade of grass that grows up new, and I just planted some more this fall, planted seeds, so that every blade of grass that grows up is a creative act of God. God's not a watchmaker who wound up his creation and set it in motion. He continues to be intimately involved with it all. And we call that intimate care and involvement providence, that he continues to provide for his creation. And so we confess with the Heidelberg Catechism that God's providence is his almighty and ever-present power, whereby as with his hand he still upholds heaven and earth and all creatures. God upholds you. God has you in his hands. God provides for you and cares for you. And then sixth, Paul claims Jesus is the head of the body, the church. So we only exist because of him as our creator and as our Lord and Savior. By his life and death and resurrection, Jesus has joined us to himself. And in terms of the previous claim, we only hold together as a church through him. Without Jesus as the center of our focus, without Jesus upholding us and undergirding us, the church falls and falls apart. Seventh, Paul says that Jesus is the beginning. He doesn't say the Alpha, he does say the Arche. Alpha is in that, but it's the first, it's the beginning. He's the one who starts something. He's the first one in a series of things. And Jesus is the Alpha, the first, as in the first and the last. And through Isaiah, the prophet, God told his people, this is God speaking, I am the first and the last, and apart from me, there is no other God. And so at the end of the Bible in Revelation 22, Jesus makes it clear that he is God when he takes this claim for this title to himself. And in John's vision in Revelation, Jesus says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. And we could add those words from Isaiah, I am God and there is no other. Next, Jesus is also the first person to rise from the dead, never to die again. And because of his resurrection, we too have hope of resurrection. And in teaching about the resurrection, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15, Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. But each in turn, Christ, the first fruits, and then when he comes, those who belong to him. So just like earlier when Paul called Jesus the preeminent one, the one who is before all creation, here too, Jesus is the preeminent one who rose from the dead. Jesus has first place honor, the highest honor of being the first to resurrect from the dead. In fact, Jesus has such a high place in the resurrection that he is the resurrection. That's what he told to the sisters of Lazarus. Do you believe he's going to rise again from the dead? Yes, Lord, I believe that in the end he will rise from the dead. And Jesus said, I am the resurrection. He lives in me. And Jesus had the power to call Lazarus back from the dead. The only sad thing is that in that story, we're never told it, but Lazarus had to die again. Because Jesus is the first to rise from the dead, never to die again. And it's only in him that we have hope of our resurrection. And so Paul sums this all up ninthly by saying that Jesus holds first place in all things. He holds the highest rank and influence. God the Father has raised him and seated him at his right hand. He holds the highest honor, the highest distinction. And the writer of the book of Hebrews wanted to show how much better, how superior Jesus is to everything that he wrote. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. And after he provided purification from sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. That's how high Jesus has been raised up to sit at and to be equal in authority and power by being seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And Jesus holds this high honor and position because Paul says, in him and by him and through him and to him, God has reconciled all things. In Jesus, God has restored the relationship God had with his creation before sin entered the picture. In Jesus, God himself came to set things right. And Paul says that the fullness of God was pleased to be present in Jesus. He was pleased to dwell in Jesus. Just like God would dwell in or fill the temple with his glory, so the fullness of God was at home or dwelling in Jesus. I don't know what it's like for you when you've gone on a couple weeks vacation or you've been camping for a while and you get home. What's home like for you? It's good, isn't it? It's good to be home in familiar places. So just like when we come home from a vacation, it feels good to be at home in a familiar place. All the fullness of God was pleased to dwell or to be at home in the familiar place of Jesus. All the fullness of God in Jesus was like, this is pretty good. This is really good. It's good to be at home here. And all the fullness of God was at home and present in the Lord Jesus Christ. And it was by him, by who Jesus is and what he did, that God then completely reconciled us and brought us back to a right relationship with him. And Jesus did that by dying on the cross. Now, Paul makes it clear that this reconciliation and peace with God were won by the blood of his cross, his suffering, and his death. So through Jesus, God reconciled all things to himself. All things, things on earth and things in heaven. And then to bring it home for us, Paul adds to this list of 9 ways that Jesus has first place in time, honor, position. 9 ways that Jesus is supremely Lord over all creation. Paul adds to this a 10th thing. Us. Jesus is Lord and he has reconciled us to God the Father. We are included. Jesus is Lord over us. And Paul wrote this letter to people living in a culture that worshiped other things than Christ. They worshiped angels in the culture and the climate of Colossae. And people became proud of what they thought they saw or what they knew about them, how they could possibly lay out the divisions of the invisible things, that they could classify them. And maybe we'll look at this later in a week or so. But for now, Paul elevates Christ and shows him as having first place over everything in creation and everything in their culture. So what gets elevated in our culture? What tries to replace Christ as having the highest place in our lives? I think this has been a very interesting week as God's been leading me through this passage. This has been a very interesting week in music and sports. Two fields of entertainment have been brought together. Taylor Swift is putting out a concert film about her Eras tour. And the movie is not out yet. It's not out yet. It comes out this Friday, I believe. Am I right on that? You don't know. I'm looking at you. Thanks for responding. I think it comes out this Friday, but it's already sold. It hasn't come out yet. It's got a week to go. It's already sold more than $100 million in advance ticket sales. What does our culture worship? And it's been rumored that Taylor Swift is dating Travis Kelce, the tight end of the Super Bowl champion Kansas City Chiefs. And this week, Swiftie fans of Taylor Swift have started watching football. Because Taylor was seen in a private booth with Travis's mother. And the Business Insider reports the Chiefs game against the New York Jets last week Sunday night saw the highest viewership for a Sunday TV show since the Super Bowl, according to a report from NBC Sports, which aired the game. At its highest point, the game saw 29.4 million viewers during the second quarter, based on preliminary data from NBC Sports, and that's a 22% increase from the team's Week 4 game last season. All because Taylor Swift was there. What does our culture worship? As a culture, we elevate celebrities, whether in music, sports, or film. We put them in a place where, in a sense, we worship their every move, what they do and what they say. We follow them. It captures our attention and our focus and occupies our hearts and our minds. Or, as a culture, we elevate ourselves. We put focus on what we want, what we need. We often put ourselves and our longings ahead of everyone and everything else. We need me time. Me time is focusing on oneself and only doing things that I want to do. And direction psychology says it's amazing how our mind and our body communicate with us, and regularly undertaking me time allows you to understand the message of your body and your mind and take actions according to what you need to be healthy. Me time. Well, I believe in taking care of ourselves. I believe in staying healthy, and recharging our batteries is important. Taking care of ourselves to stay healthy, we have to be careful that our wants, our needs, don't become the main focus of our lives, and that we elevate them above what Jesus wants of us. See, at one time, we were shut out from fellowship and intimacy with God. And what a horrible place that is to be. But Satan tempted us to put our desires above our relationship with God. And we sinned against God by going against what he wanted for us. We became openly hostile to God, hiding from him. And we were expelled from the paradise of a perfect, loving relationship with God. And Paul implies that the disobedience of our first parents carried over into our lives. That we resisted God. And our sin against God starts in our heart and our mind and works its way out into our actions. See, when teaching his disciples the difference between following the rules of people and following God, Jesus said the things that come out of a person's mouth come from the heart. And these are the things that defile a person, because it's out of the heart. It's not the actions themselves, but they start. They have their root in our heart, and it's out of the heart that come murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, and slander. I don't think we want to admit that. That when I'm doing something bad, it's coming out of my heart. It's coming out of my mind. The beautiful thing is that in Jesus Christ, that old way of living has been put to death on the cross. And I don't have to live that way any longer. I can now be changed. I can be different. Now through faith in Jesus, that old way of life has been done away with. And we're encouraged to be different, to live differently because of that. Paul told the Romans, don't conform to the pattern of this world. Don't conform to the elevation of celebrities or self. Don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Think differently and start to live differently. See Jesus Christ as Lord over your heart and your thoughts. Paul says that Jesus has first place over all things, over creation, both seen and unseen. Jesus has first place over culture and the things that we focus our attention on, the things that we worship. Jesus is over all of those, and Jesus has set us right with God. He's reconciled our relationship with him. Jesus came in the flesh and died on the cross to make us holy, to set us apart exclusively for God. And his blood has purified us and made us clean. Jesus wants to present us to the Father unblemished, without any damage, and blameless before him. To be unblemished is to be without fault. And it comes from the idea of a fragrant ointment that pleases the person that it's been given to, a plant that has a beautiful fragrance to it. Like when a woman poured ointment on the feet of Jesus and the fragrance filled the room. Unblemished. Beautiful, fragrant offering. And to be blameless is to stand in someone's presence without any accusation against us. Satan is known as our accuser, and he wants to shame us and to indict us before God with everything we've ever done wrong. But Jesus, by taking away our sin, by dying on the cross, now there is nothing to be called to account against us. I know we're not perhaps so vocal, but could I say that again? Jesus, by taking away our sin, there is now nothing to be held to account against us. Yes. Yes. Can we imagine, I don't care what side of the political spectrum you're on, I'm going to put out two examples here, but can we imagine if both Hunter Biden and Donald Trump came into court this week and the judge was able to say to them both, there are no charges against you. Everything's been cleared up and taken care of. You're free to go. No more accusations against either of you. That's what Jesus did for us. He's reconciled us to himself, and now he presents us to the Father holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. Satan has nothing on us. So Jesus holds first place over all creation, over all things seen and unseen, over cultures and things we might give our attention and thoughts to. Jesus is the first to rise from the dead. He has first place in our lives and the lives of believers. And over all things, Jesus has first place over. Of all the things, he has first place over us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Will you join me in prayer? Lord Jesus, may you be lifted high. You are already lifted high by the Father. Because of your humility, you've been raised to the highest place of honor and seated at the right hand of God the Father. But may we lift you up in our thoughts, in our hearts, in our minds, in our worship. And may we give you, Lord, place over everything in our lives and place over us, your church, together and as individuals. Have first place. In your name we pray. Amen. Will you join me in a song that fits these words so well from Colossians 1:15 to 23, that Jesus has first place? And if you're able, will you stand in the presence of your Lord and Savior and acknowledge this before him? And if you're not able to stand, stand in your heart, stand in your mind, and give him first place. There's anything that you would like to talk with somebody about, I make myself available. There are others from this congregation who would gladly talk with you as well, but please feel free to approach us. We want you to feel welcomed, and we want to be hospitable to you and open our lives to you as well, to share that Jesus is Lord over everything that we bring together and bring to him. There is a time where we have fellowship together out in our common area. We invite you to make your way out there after this time of worship. But now, as God's people, receive this grace. Jesus is Lord. He is exalted and raised over you. You are his body, his people. And through him and from him and to him are all grace and peace. To you, from him, amen.